I play a lot of foosball. Some might even say too much foosball.
And you know what? I'd even agree with that assessment. It takes valuable time away from more important things in life, like building computers instead of video games. But one day, I had an epiphany. If I could make a robot to automate all my foosball playing away, it would free up my productivity to re-waste on things that contribute even less to society.
8 months and many thousands of dollars later, I present to you the world's best autonomous foosball table, Foosbar. This thing works amazingly well. It can defend. It can pass. And it can even shoot faster than it's physically possible for a human to react to. And it does all this completely autonomously, without any human manually controlling it. But first, let's see how I made it. If you've never played it before, foosball, also known as table soccer, is a two-player game where you control a set of plastic players mounted on rods to try and get a ball into your opponent's goal. I want to robotically control one side of the table so it can play autonomously against a human opponent. If you look online, you'll see I'm actually not the first person to attempt this. This was initially discouraging, but they all have something in common. At least as far as I can tell, they play purely reactively, and any goals are mostly the result of chaotic bouncing and the robot reacting quickly. Instead, for my table, I want to try having fine ball control. This means first stopping the ball, then setting up passes and shots while reacting to the human player trying to block them.
This is a much, much harder problem, but if I can solve it, I think that it will probably make my robot the best in the world.
There are three main components to the project: robotics, vision, and software.
The first step in making a self-playing foosball table is to, well, get a foosball table.
I realized after editing that I somehow don't have a single video of the table by itself to show, but I do already have a fully dimensionally accurate 3D model of it instead. What this says about my relative merit as an engineer versus filmmaker is up to interpretation.
The table's not of the best quality, but that seems like a problem for future me, and he seems like a bit of a jerk, given he expects me to solve problems like this for him.
It was a bit of a pain to set up, but at least I only had to do it once. After the table is the interesting part, the robotics. If you think about it, there are only two types of motion that you need to control a foosball player: side to side and rotational. Once you can control one rod, you can duplicate it for all the others. The trouble comes from the fact that you need to control both of these axes at once independently. The design I settled on was the most obvious. I have two motors. One is directly connected to the rod and it controls the rotation. That motor is mounted on a linear belt drive, which is powered by a second motor below. When the second motor rotates, it causes the rod to go in and out. It's important to control the speed and position of the motors precisely, so that the robot can make small adjustments to the ball. It's actually pretty doable to make such a system yourself. The result is a servo. I need very powerful motors though, and this one's pretty small, so since I don't have a bigger blender, I decided to use off-the-shelf parts instead. I decided to go with Technic Clearpath SC motors for this, which Technic set me up for in return for showing you how to make something as cool as this with them. These are more powerful, drop-in replacements for stepper motors, which I was considering using, but would have been underpowered. What makes them really good for this is the software control. With just a USB connection to my desktop and some control boards they sell, I can use the software API to command the motors to any position or speed I want. The rest of the construction was surprisingly easy compared to what I expected. It turns out that there's a big market for CNC machine replacement linear belt drives, which are exactly what I need, so I bought some of those. I mounted all the electronics to an exposed piece of wood, which in my opinion looks aesthetically cool enough to justify making some OSHA people watching this video a little bit sad. After all this, I finally had a fully working mechanical system. I don't know where the ball is yet, but by placing the ball manually and commanding the motors in a fixed sequence, I can test the table's ability to take a shot. Here it is, a bit slower if you missed it. This is pretty good, but this is actually just running at roughly half maximum speed, since at this stage I was a bit worried about damaging the belt drives. That concern was unfounded though, and at no point in the project was I limited by motor power or mechanical reliability. It was time to move on to the next challenge.
Okay, so far we have a physical system that works great, but trying to do anything is like trying to play foosball with your eyes closed. We need a way to track the ball.
I started with the simplest, dumbest idea of mounting a single camera over top of the table. Then I filter the image the camera sees for the pixels that are similar in color to the ball, and if I see a big enough blob of them together, then that's probably where the ball is. This actually worked pretty decently for simple tests. You can see the player is tracking the ball location as I move it. There was one amusing bug of the system. This is me holding the ball to test the vision system, and it correctly identifies the contour of the ball. Now this is my friend holding the ball, and where the code thinks it is based on the color in the image.
I had not yet made the best foosball robot, but at least at that point, I had the unintentional and somewhat dubious distinction of making the world's first racist foosball table. Unlike in the real world, the racism wasn't actually that much of an issue, since you don't normally put your hand over the playing area. There was a bigger problem, though.
Imagine you're the camera. Can you see the bowl? I certainly can't, and until I knock it away from underneath one of the plastic players, it's impossible to. This is called occlusion, and it's a huge headache to deal with. The first solution to this I tried was to make the playing surface transparent. Over top, there's a bunch of junk in the way, but if you look down from below, you get a perfect view of the ball. I bought some acrylic, cut it down to size, and replaced the playing surface with it. It was a bit annoying to reassemble everything, but at least I only had to do it once. Unfortunately, this did not work well. The new bottom flexed a lot and required supports from below, which kind of defeats the whole purpose of avoiding occlusion. Also, the slippery playing surface and the joints between the acrylic sheets made for a pretty horrible foosball experience. Instead of replacing the bottom, in the end I settled on a Qualisys 3D motion tracking setup. Motion tracking is incredibly cool. You arrange many cameras around the table, then calibrate them by waving an actual magic wand around where you're interested. The cameras shine infrared light and look at the reflection back, which is weak for most objects but very strong for special retroreflective markers. As long as at least two cameras can see the marker, some fancy math can determine based on the calibration earlier exactly where in 3D space the marker is. By making the ball itself into a marker, this works perfectly for this use case, since even if the ball is obscured from most cameras, only a few have to have line of sight for tracking. The cameras occasionally lose track of the ball, but for the most part this works great. All that's left is to write code to actually use this information. The high-level strategy of the table is to have several modes. If the human has possession of the ball, then the table plays defense. If the robot has control of the ball in these two rods, it tries passing the ball up to the next one. Once it gets to the forward rod, it lines up and takes the shot.
Implementing this strategy was the part of the project I was originally really looking forward to. I had a fast and repeatable motor system, as well as almost perfect location data on the ball, both of which were working better than I expected to. It turns out though that robotics is way, way harder than I originally thought. I'm a programmer at heart. When I write code, everything just works perfectly on the first try. When I occasionally have to fix other people's code with bugs in it, every problem has a clearly defined line of code that is the cause. When you're in the physical world though, all bets are off.
I'm running the exact same code here every time, starting from the same position, and you can see how many different outcomes there are. It's not that there's something wrong with the motors, the cameras, or even necessarily my software. When you're trying to precisely control a small object very quickly, any small errors compound. In the end, the only way around this was lots of trial and error trying to make the system as robust to inaccuracies as I could, but it definitely made me realize why all the other attempts at making a similar table didn't bother with controlled passing. The first thing I did was have it play defense. Unlike offense, which requires a lot of fine ball control and accurate positioning, the main constraint on defense is reaction speed, so the problems I described are less relevant. Raw speed is something that robots are just way better than a human at, so it can reliably block shots from just a single goalie defender from anywhere. After a lot of fiddling, I also had a system that could line up a shot from anywhere in reach and take it. These are both pretty awesome, but here's where I started running into a lot of problems.
Remember when I said that the table being low quality is a problem for future me? Well, past me was an idiot.
I consider myself quite good at foosball, and even I had trouble controlling the ball reliably. The players are shaped weirdly, the playing surface is slippery, and the rod alignment is extremely loose. Overall, it makes writing the software harder than it needs to be, so I decided to replace the table. Tornado tables are the golden standard for American-style foosball, so I was super happy when I reached out and they agreed to get me a T3000 tournament-legal table. Also, big thanks to Home Billiard Sales in Vancouver for arranging logistics. It was a bit of a pain to disassemble and reassemble everything once again, but at least I only had to do it once. It's hard to overstate how much of a difference a good tornado table makes for ball control. Here's me trying to execute a simple pass on the old table. The ball always slips out because of the strange foot shape and unpredictable surface. Compare this to the new table. There's no cherry picking either. This was my first take getting this on camera. I also took the time to replace the desk the motors were mounted to, since the old desk was wobbly and the two foosball tables had slightly different rod spacing. Since of course they do. At least it was only a one-time reassembly. Another problem is how deceptively complicated foosball is. For example, let's just think about the task of getting a stationary ball from an arbitrary location under the rod to the very center to line up a shot. As a human playing, I have a lot of intuition that helps me do this. If you actually try to write down every single instruction explicitly though, there are a lot of edge cases. Maybe the ball is too far out and you need to delicately drag it to the side first. Maybe it's too far off to the side, so you need to tap it gently so you can pass it laterally. Every one of these has many similar cases that has to be handled differently, and because it's a physical system with some pretty weird dynamics at slow speeds, it's almost impossible to write things in a general way that doesn't involve a lot of manual tuning of parameters.
This meant that the software part of the project took months longer than planned, and there were a few times I was pretty close to wanting to give up. Luckily I didn't though, since it was all worth it. This thing is awesome. I've been playing against it throughout the entire process, so I enlisted the help of my younger brother, who's never played against it before, to demonstrate in a 1-to-10 game.
Alright, so before we get started, do you have any predictions on how this is going to go?
My prediction is probably 11-0, to be honest, for me.
Alright. And just so everyone's on the same page, what would you kind of rate yourself as a foosball player?
Probably a 10. I mean, if I think I put my mind to it, I probably could become a professional foosball player, so
okay.
A 10.
And how many times have you played in the last 2 months?
Probably, like, 0 times.
Okay, but sounds good.
I like my chances.
Let's see how it goes.
The game starts out with an early string of points for the robot.
What the heck is that?
Basically, every time it gets control with its offensive rod, it's almost guaranteed to score a point, since the robot's shot is just straight up too fast for a human to react to.
What?
On the other hand, when the ball is chaotically bouncing around quickly, the robot struggles predicting the trajectory, so it lets in a few goals this way.
On goal!
The middle of the game lets the robot's passing skills really shine. Depending on which rod the ball is on, the code executes different passes, since the number of players on each bar differs. As the game goes on, the coding on the ball that makes it into a marker for the cameras wears off a bit, and the vision system sometimes loses track of the ball, which my brother doesn't hesitate to take full advantage of. This incident also proved that there was at least one bug left in the code.
Are you scoring us off?
Yeah. Robot's malfunctioning or something.
It's 9-9, and the next point decides the game. I'll let you watch the rest. Of course, you might also wonder how well it does against someone who's more experienced at the game. Here it is playing defense, while I'm attacking it with the yellow players. While I can occasionally ricochet a shot in, the robot blocks me extremely consistently. It plays so reactively that it feels very different to play against than a human. It always feels like it was just luckily in the right position already every time, even though when you play it back on video, you can see that it does in fact just move there really quickly. Here it is playing offense, now with me defending. I have even less of a chance than when I was attacking. Even when I block in the middle correctly, it scores by moving to the side first, but it's crazy seeing how small of an opening it needs to be able to just shoot straight. I can honestly say that for the specific tasks of both offensive shots and the defense of those shots, the robot is flat out better than me. Unfortunately, that still doesn't mean it beats me in regular games. It loses control of the ball a lot, and the passes aren't very consistent, despite how cool they look. Other than those two issues, I'm thrilled with the table overall, and it's great for practicing against ever since all my friends stopped playing with me because I wouldn't shut up about the robot foosball table or whatever. So that's pretty much it, right? I accomplished my goals of engineering a self-playing foosball table, building it, and playing against a human. But since when has accomplishing all of your stated goals been the natural end to a project? Remember that 3D model of the table I showed at the beginning? It ended up being pretty useless, and I even changed the table I was using, but the sunk cost fallacy whispered at me from the shadows regardless. So finally, I couldn't help it. I caved into the path of least resistance and did the obvious thing of making a full 3D web app that synchronizes live position data of the rods and ball with my control software. The really cool thing here is that everything is done over the internet, so I don't even have to be here to control the table. I actually gave a big presentation where I had a full live demo of the table completely remotely.
You can see I can select which rod I'm currently using, and then let's say I move it.
It's pretty clunky to control the table, so it's not that much use practically, but in what other context can you say that you've played real-life foosball with your friend over your phone? As with all my projects, all the code and design files are open source and available on a public GitHub in the description.
If you enjoyed this, please like, subscribe, and show this to your friends.
If it's somehow not obvious, these projects take an obscene amount of time, so it's very much appreciated.